Welcome back to Power Talks. We are in conversation with Ms. Pirkko-Liisa Kyösthila, the Sergeant Affairs of Finland to Nepal. As you might have known already that in Nepal, the culture of politics dominates all the other sectors that affect the daily life of common people. Despite political chaos, how important is it that we uphold creative things, we uphold the culture, and also focus on economic growth?
Nepal's culture is unique and rich. And I'm sure that it's an endless source of inspiration for Nepali people, for artists, and it is the same for us foreigners as well. So it's essential to maintain the culture and creativity. But as well, it's very important to work for strong, inclusive economic growth.
In February this year, Finland's Minister of Foreign Trade and Development, Dr. Paavo, visited Nepal, and he promised to double the aid for Nepal by 2012. Now that the government has changed in Nepal and the world faces recession, will this generous offer still stay valid?
It's still valid, but it's good to remember that in order to reach that goal, the sincere efforts by all parties involved are needed. We, development partners of Nepal, we are growingly concerned about the security situation. Our operational space is getting more limited, and we follow this situation and development very carefully and closely. So it might be, in fact, that this aid commitment Finland made, the implementation of this commitment can be difficult, for instance, due to the security situation. And for that reason, I would like to draw the ball in this issue to the court of the government of Nepal.
During the earlier Prime Minister Prachanda's visit to Finland, this was in April 2009, this year itself, was there any concrete outcome or did it just serve as a friendly visit?
High-level visits are a central part of diplomatic relations between countries. And we have had ministerial visits between Nepal and Finland over the last years. But the last visit of a Nepali prime minister took place almost 16 years ago. So once when the government, based on the elections, was established, we felt that it was the time to welcome prime minister for a visit to Finland. And during his visits, we discussed many issues in common interest and concern. For instance, in order to expand our development program with Nepal, we were very interested in hearing and listening to the Prime Minister's views of issues like peace, security, human rights, and so on. And as well, recently Finland signed an agreement on promotion and protection of investments with Nepal. So his visit to Finland promoted as well trade and investments, which both are well below the potential, and he was accompanied by a business delegation.
Now that the government has changed dramatically in Nepal, and since Finland heads the presidency of European Union, how has the EU heads of missions in Nepal looked at this current change?
EU heads of mission have been concerned over the damaging consequences the ever-changing political situation might have for the peace process. And of course, delivering the needs of Nepali people suffer as well when there is turmoil in the politics.
On 26th May last month, you led the delegation of European Union heads of missions to meet the new Prime Minister Madhav Kumar Nepal and urged him to collaborate with all political parties to find a way forward. How was your message taken by the new Prime Minister, and how does the EU heads of missions look at the formation of the new government?
Our discussion with Prime Minister Nepal was positive and constructive. Prime Minister Nepal shared our view that it is important to seek for common ground and continue working closely together. It is indeed essential now to that the parties within themselves and between each other are building on cooperation and consensus. By definition, disagreements and consensus are part of the politics and policy making. But at the same time, it is important to remember that Nepali people, they are in need of basic services, and delivering these basic services to the people should be the priority for every single politician.
For Nepal to move ahead, the politicians and the citizens have to focus on economy and trade. But what is it that Nepal lacks that does not allow the country to focus on economy and globalization?
As we have already earlier in our discussion touched upon, political instability, lack of public security, rule of law, and lack of basic infrastructure, all of these have an adverse effect on the economy. For Nepal, being now in the very crucial transitional phase, it is important to finalize the peace process and constitution drafting. And only then the economic progress really can take place.
You were born in a forest village and you have great interest in constructive works, in construction. We have a similar background in Nepal where we have lots of forest villages, and I myself come from one. But we lack the sense of constructiveness, and as a result the country is falling apart. What is a message that you'd like to give to our country and our people?
This is interesting that you refer to my background. Indeed, I was born in a Finnish forest village, and still now, always when I have holiday and I go Finland, I go back to my roots and to my village, and construction is very literal in my case, because my major hobby is building a wooden house in the Finnish forest. So I think that when we are referring to Nepal's situation, it's important to get the own house in order first, then everything else is possible, and this we can practice at the individual level, at the national level. So this is the way we are working, but I am doing it as well in my private life through building this house. And in that activity, my friends have been able to participate over the years, but during the last couple of years I have realized that I don't have any more too many friends coming to visit me to my village, because they know what's waiting for them.
Lots of
work at the construction site.
We'll continue with our conversation after a short break. Do stay with us.